Good morning, everybody. I'm Strobe Talbott, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you here to the Brookings Institution this morning. A particular welcome to the Diplomatic Corps, which is represented here by quite a number of the ambassadors here in town, to Ambassador Ammann and our friends at the German Embassy, and also our friends at the Friedrich Ebert Foundation. As all of you know, this event is timely for some somewhat unsettling and potentially sobering reasons. We have an opportunity to hear from the German Federal Foreign Minister Steinmeier on a day when there are unconfirmed, somewhat contradictory, but nonetheless rather worrisome reports out of Ukraine. We woke up this morning to accusations from senior Ukrainian officials that Russia has occupied strategically important infrastructure sites in Crimea. Now, this story is changing by the minute, and no doubt more information, or perhaps misinformation, will flow over the wires and over the TV even while we are conducting this meeting. But this much is for sure. Ukraine is a challenge for Europe, and it's a challenge for the transatlantic community, including the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. Germany is a leader of that community and a leader of that alliance. That's why Brookings, with the indispensable help of the Robert Bosch Foundation, is establishing a German senior fellowship in our Center on the United States and Europe, directed by Fiona Hill. Fiona will moderate a discussion now with our guest of honor, who, by the way, was in Ukraine last Friday. And then she will open up the conversation to all of you. Mr. Minister, thank you for coming to Brookings. It's good to see you. Thank you for your own leadership, and the podium is yours.
Thank you, Strobe, for your kind words of welcoming me. Dear Fiona, dear friends, ladies and gentlemen, it's good to be back in DC. I always enjoy coming back. As opposed to most of the crowded capitals, I know DC is a city that is spacious and that lets you see the sky, in that it reminds me a little bit of Berlin. There is another similarity with Berlin. No matter which bar you walk into, no matter what time of day it is, you will be sure find somebody talking about politics. I quite enjoyed this culture of permanent debate. When I first came here, when I was 35, visiting my girlfriend during her year abroad. Today she is my wife since 19 years, and whenever I'm back in DC, I'm still enjoying those debates and those bars. On my way here on the plane, I was flicking through some old issues of the New Yorker magazine. What I enjoyed most, and you may find that surprising from a German, were the cartoons. One I remember in particular, it showed husband and wife sitting on the sofa at home, husband with a painful expression on his face, and his wife says, "Don't be so hard on yourself. Let me do that." You may guess why I'm describing this to you. The discords that happen in every long and proven relationship, they are not foreign to the transatlantic relationship either. Being bored by routines, mistrust creeping in, being annoyed at the little differences, feeling the draw of new attractions or pivoting to other oceans. Yes, these are the facts about us. But what I want to suggest to you today is not a therapy session for an elderly couple. What I want to do, ladies and gentlemen, is to explore what this long and proven relationship can mean for an entirely new generation. Let's begin this discussion with another fact. It may sound worrying, but it's not. The fact is, to the generation of tomorrow, the value of transatlantic partnership is in no way as self-evident as it is to my generation, and looking around, as to many of us in this room. And that shouldn't surprise us, because the world just looks so very different through the eyes of different generations. Take, for example, your Secretary of State, my colleague John Kerry. The world of his youth was the world of the aftermath of World War II. As a little boy, he cycled through the rubble of Berlin Kurfürstendamm. He looked up at the first big house that was being rebuilt, and it had a sign, supported by the Marshall Plan. These images implanted the transatlantic partnership in John Kerry's moral cosmos, and not only for him. In the same way for myself. The world of my youth was the world divided into two blocks, East and West, black and white. As a student, I lived in a town not even 70 miles away from the Iron Curtain that ran right through the middle of my country. And I remember my student days quite well, because I took many more years studying than probably most of the students in this room. We were certain which side we belonged to. We were certain. To us, living at the front lines of the Western world, this certainty was the anchor of our security. But today, when I talk to my daughter, it turns out that hers is an entirely different world. That is, if I get to talk to her at all, because, you know, she is 17, the world she is growing up in is a world more open, more diverse, more fascinating, but also more confusing than ever. Each continent, each way of life is just a tweet or a blog post away. She asked me, how do I find my own way in all these openness? Now I might tell her to look first to Europe and across the Atlantic. She will look at me and say, why should I care? I might respond that the US and Europe stand for the community of Western values. At this point, she will roll her eyes and turn back to her smartphone. I'm sure these young generations are not against values, and they are not against our values. But I think value is not enough. What my daughter's generation wants to know is how to put these values to work in the 21st century. There are many tough questions that she and her generation ask. What will my job look like in a completely interconnected world? How will I still be in control when much of what I do and much of what I am happens online? How will we keep our planet safe when threats spread around at broadband speed? How will we treat this planet's natural resources when an ever-growing population asks for the same standards of living that we are used to. With these big questions on their plate, young people have every reason to ask, why should we care about transatlantic partnership? Well, you shouldn't care just because people of my age are nostalgic or afraid of change. I personally believe that the US and Europe remain partners of first choice for tackling the problems we face. But the reality is that a new generation will only accept this belief, and carry it forward if we adapt our relationship to their questions. Only if we put our values to work on the questions of today will young people care about our partnership. To be concrete, the first value we need to put to work is opportunity. In his State of the Union a few weeks ago, President Obama said, opportunity is who we are. Well, you should tell your president, that makes two of us. Enlarging opportunity across borders is what drives European Union today. I think that opportunity is just the right starting point to think about transatlantic ties for a new generation. After all, when you are my daughter's age, all you see is opportunity. And when President Obama said opportunity is who we are, there is one little word I would have added, and that may sound very European to you. I would say it's equal opportunity. Equal opportunity is who we are. That every young person gets a fair shot in life, regardless of gender, or skin color, or zip code, or pocket money, that is a promise of our democracy. And let's be honest, we are not keeping that promise in every part of Europe or the United States today. If we share the challenge, let's share the solutions. We should open up a debate, a platform for policies and experiences to widen opportunities on both sides. To name just one example, we can learn from your experience with the federal minimum wage that we are currently introducing in Germany. And you can learn from our experience with the dual vocational training system. Also, did you know that in Germany, the proportion of people born abroad is just as large as in the US, namely round about 13%. Germany, just like the US, has become a diverse society. Let's learn from each other how to turn diversity into strength. Mutual curiosity is still the strongest tie between our young people. I'm very sure of that. And just to prove my point, my 70 years old daughter usually doesn't show too much interest in my official business. But the one time in the past year she was absolutely determined was to accompany me to an official event was when George Clooney came to present Monument Man at the Berlin Film Festival. So what I want to say, it is this curiosity that our opportunities are built on, cultural, social, economic. Every dollar, every euro we invest into this exchange, ladies and gentlemen, is money well invested. Our single biggest lever of opportunity is the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership. What TTIP will do is more than cutting tariffs. It will cut the red tape and the special interest that stands in the way of innovation. Most of all, this will benefit the small and medium-sized companies. Speaking on TTIP brings me to the second value that we need to put to work. TTIP isn't just about trade and investment, and perhaps jobs. It's about setting standards. The planet that our children are growing up on is becoming, as I said, more interconnected and more crowded than ever before. So more than ever, we need a fair set of rules by which we treat each other and the planet we live on. TTIP is a huge opportunity to shape the rules of the next phase of globalization together. And let me be clear, neither side will lower its standards when it comes to the protection and safety of its citizens. Quite the contrary. The goal is to agree on high-level standards that can serve as a benchmark for other countries. In our view, TTIP is a landmark for free trade worldwide, not a retreat into bilateralism. In our view, TTIP will inspire our diversity, not reduce to uniformity. We also need a global rule for our environment and natural resources. Climate change is a threat to our children's prosperity, health, increasingly to their political security. I'm glad that President Obama and Secretary Kerry have renewed their commitment to act. Germany will put climate change on the top of their agenda during our G8 presidency in the next year, in 2015. After all, if the US and Europe don't lead the way, how will they work things out? How will we work things out on the global scale? Talk of rules may sound abstract, but it truly is not. When my daughter looks at this open world, it is rules that will have to make sure she can navigate it safely. It is rules that turn the world's offerings into opportunities rather than threats. In no other area is this need for rules as apparent as in the internet. And in case you were wondering, from our perspective, it's not been going very well so far. Because the internet has brought us closer than ever before, the loss of trust runs all the deeper, especially among young people who lead much of their lives online. I'm not here to pass, you know that, I'm not here to pass judgment on Edward Snowden, but one thing is clear. The practices he revealed have tested the trust of America's friends to an extent where it threatens to get in the way of all the other tasks and all the other opportunities that we have. And just to clarify, the problem is not the political trouble that the news of these practices have caused us. The problem are the practices themselves. And here, not only the wiretapping of members of our government. We shouldn't allow a logic of mistrust to contaminate all the areas where cooperation holds the greater mutual benefit. So instead of more confrontation, let me, and that is what I did yesterday in my exchange with John Kerry, let me offer a change of perspective. Finding the right rules to govern the digital world is a huge challenge. We both face the challenge and we both haven't figured it out. So I suggest we work together on that solutions we need. How to govern the internet, how to protect European and American data, how to tap the huge economic potential of the fourth industrial revolution, and how to keep us safe at the same time. That is why I am suggesting a broader transatlantic cyber dialogue that involves government agencies, but also companies and civil society. I hope that the young generation from Silicon Valley and from Berlin and Munich will take part in this dialogue, finding a common understanding of the proper rules for the age of big data is a defining challenge, not only for our relationship, but for the world of the 21st century. This challenge is also a debate that goes to the heart of our democracies, in the United States as well as in Europe. It is a debate about freedom and security, about private sphere and public interest, and how to balance them all in this digital age. None of us have found the right balance yet. That is why emotions run high and controversies are fierce. Democracy is always a work in progress, even in this country where it is over 200 years old. In that way, a heated debate is also a sign of healthy democracy. After all, other countries under different regimes are not even having this debate. I think we should share this debate across the Atlantic. For reasons of culture and history, we will not end up with completely the same answers on every issue, but the basic principle is what connects us. That is up to democracy and not to private companies or to government agencies. That is up to democracy to set the rules of the game. I see some of you looking at the clock, probably wondering, when is he going to talk about the bread and butter business of foreign policy? The answer is no. But I talked about values first for a reason. These values, opportunity, fairness, freedom, democracies, we owe them not only just to our own children. They are values that young people dream of far beyond our borders. They are, for instance, the dream of many young people on the Maidan in Kiev. When the struggle for their dream was escalating into bloodshed last week, my Polish and French colleagues and I myself, we traveled to Kiev to try to break the spiral and bring the parties back to the table. The odds were indeed small, but the agreement we achieved allowed the country to step back from the brink of a civil war. The latest signs still leave me worried, so we are keeping working to ensure a peaceful transition, and this transition will have to be achieved, first of all, by the Ukrainians themselves. But Europe, the United States, and Russia should work to provide Ukraine with stability, political as well as economic, rather than pulling it further apart. Ukraine, ladies and gentlemen, is one example in a larger picture. Neither the United States nor Europe can take on its global responsibility alone. But as one president who inspired both of our nations once said, united, there is little we cannot do. German foreign policy, firmly embedded in its European and transatlantic partnership, is willing to carry its share. I'm committed to a foreign policy that will expand and leverage the toolbox of diplomacy in order to act earlier, more substantively, more decisively, to prevent and to solve conflicts. In some cases, Europe will take the diplomatic lead, as we are doing it in Ukraine, for instance. In other cases, the U.S. will take the diplomatic lead, as Secretary Kerry is currently doing with great energy in the Middle East peace process. But our division of labor will only work out with the combined strengths we can muster. That is why we expressed our full support for the peace effort when the German and Israeli government met in Jerusalem 3 days ago. Diplomacy is perception, as Henry Kissinger likes to say. It requires seeing the world through a lens that might not always be one's own. I believe that our joint efforts will only be fruitful if we keep our channels of diplomacy open wherever we can. I'm convinced that diplomatic persistence pays off eventually. Here are two examples. And I'm sure you know that after 10 long years of negotiating, I was taking part already during my first period as foreign minister. After 10 long years of negotiating, we are finally seeing results in our negotiations with Iran in this E+3+3 format. And in Syria, the bloodshed is not over. But we were able to avoid the last step of escalation because we undertook a joint initiative with Russia, with the United States, with Europe, to get rid of the chemical weapons. Now each must play their part to make sure that these murderous weapons are actually destroyed. As I said earlier, I spent many years at the university. I was working on my PhD when a few miles east, the wall started, the Berlin Wall started to crumble. At that time, there were many who thought that the end of the Cold War would mark the ultimate victory of the Western model, as it were, perhaps already the end of history. I think we are far from it. We live in a world that has lost its old order, but hasn't found a new one yet. New powers are rising, each with their own history, own culture, own proudness, their way of doing things. And even if most of them are not exactly Westminster democracies, each is determined to have a say in the world. Some people in the West reacted with resignation. After all, global population growth is making Western societies fade into the shadow. Some reacted with nostalgia for the golden transatlantic times, but those, by the way, never existed. There have always been differences, as you know, from Schroeder and Bush in the years of Iraq all the way back to Adenauer and the same inspiring President GFK, whom I quoted above. Others reacted by turning inward. For some years now, both Europe and the United States have been preoccupied by their crises at home. And still others reacted by turning away from the old Western alliance. After all, the new power centers of the world would lie elsewhere. I think that none of these reactions is right. I think we should neither resign, nor despair, nor turn in, nor turn away. We should welcome the competition of this multipolar world and be confident that the Western model still has the most to offer. The ultimate test in the transatlantic relationship is alive and well, if not, if we can look at each other and say, there are no differences between us. The ultimate test is if we stand side by side, look at the world around us, and embrace the competition. Just a few weeks ago in Munich, my colleague John Kerry called for a transatlantic Renaissance. I couldn't agree more with him. But let's keep in mind, the Renaissance wasn't the rebuilding of ancient Rome. The Renaissance was the building of something new, inspired by the values of the past. And what is even more important, the Renaissance was not built by the ancient Romans, it was built by new generations. By this, I do not mean to say that I'm ancient, despite of perhaps the color of my hair. What I'm saying is, friends, it is you, the generations of tomorrow, who will build those bridges. They will be based on your connections, initiatives, and communities. And I want to thank, at my end of this speech, I want to thank the many foundations, universities, NGOs, also here in this city and in this room. Your tireless work is the foundation, I'm very sure, of our Renaissance. In a world more open than ever before, young people face tough questions. They are global questions. They are not unique to the United States or Europe, but there is still something that makes our partnership unique. That, when we tackle those tough questions, we share the starting point of our history and the compass of our values. We may be an old couple, yes, but our values are still move us a long way ahead. And if we put those values to work on today's tough questions, young people have all the reasons to care for each other across the Atlantic. So let's do care and put them to work. I'm sure it's worth it. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Farmer Steinmeier. That was a very inspiring speech. And as you're getting wired up for the next phase of our discussion today, I'd just like to set the scene for what I know are going to be a lot of very stimulating questions from the audience. In actual fact, I've had quite a long time to sit here as listening to you and to gaze out on the audience here and to see that many of the things that you talked about are illustrated here. You ended your speech by talking about the various universities, NGOs, and foundations that represent the transatlantic relationship, and I think we have pretty much a representation from everyone here. I'd like to actually just mention a few. In his address, Strobe talked about some of the important partnerships that we have here at Brookings. We're setting up this new fellowship with the help of the Robert Bosch Stiftung in Stuttgart, which we're very pleased about. But there have been many other institutions here in DC, as you know, who have been working on Germany as well as the transatlantic relationship. We're very grateful to have Pia Bungarten here from Friedrich Ebert and many of her colleagues from the German foundations, named after some of the great political figures that you mentioned or intimated in your speech. We have the American Institute for Contemporary German Studies that's housed in our building with us, but is linked to SAIS, Johns Hopkins, and I see many people here from the Center for Transatlantic Relations across the road. We have the German Marshall Fund. I can see people, of course, one of the most famous products of that transatlantic relationship, going back to the mentioning of Senator Kerry cycling around in a ruined Berlin at the end of World War II. We have many of our colleagues from the European Diplomatic Corps here. In addition to your colleague, Ambassador Amon from the German Embassy, we have the ambassador from the EU, many colleagues from other European delegations, their ambassadors here. We also have, most importantly, from your perspective, some representatives of the new generation. I think a lot of them are probably in the overflow room, because as you know from your own student days, you're always late to everything. In fact, I would have been late had I not have to sit here. And we did tell everybody to get here early, and of course it was somewhat the older generation who got the message so they could get a seat. Nonetheless, a few enterprising young professionals from Germany and Europe are sitting here closer in the audience, and somehow we'll try to bring in the people from the overflow room. We have hundreds of other people here, not just the people you're seeing here. So this shows, again, that people really do care about this relationship. We have young German and European professionals, academics and students here, and I'll have to make sure that we call upon them during the discussion. You'll also have seen lots of people with their new media. I think you were getting tweeted all over the place. I saw lots of people with their smartphones. You know, I think you're on cameras and you're being webcast at this particular moment too. So I think you know, you're out there in cyberspace in a way that you want to be right now, of course. You mentioned George Clooney. I really wish he was here in the audience. But anyway, we can work on that. And hopefully one day, you know, we might be able to have you and George Clooney both here. And then we really will have a big turnout. Climate change is unfortunately alive and kicking today. I mean, we're colder here than Moscow. And we have been actually for several weeks. And I think that's one of the vagaries. The polar vortex seems to have settled over Washington. If you'd like to take it with you back to Germany, we'd be really thrilled. But unfortunately, I don't think that's going to happen. But in any case, I think that all of the themes that you have mentioned are really much alive and thriving. As Strobe said, we're meeting against the backdrop of really what has been one of the earliest tests of certainly your foreign ministership. With Ukraine and the ongoing standoff now there and developments in Crimea. But there are so many other issues that are on our agenda today. So without any further ado, I can see lots of stirrings of people in the audience who would like me to get on with getting the questions. You have your translator next to you just in case some of the funny accents in the audience throw you off. You've got one to contend with here, and there's lots of other accents out there that are just waiting for you. I'd like to take the first question from someone younger than the average. And you've done it, sir, over here. I know we have a microphone coming. And please identify yourself, because I'm getting older, so I can't always see everybody either, and I don't know everyone's names. But if you could say who you are, and then your question, and we'll go straight to the Foreign Minister. Thank you.
Sure. Thanks, Mr. Steinmeier, for this really inspiring speech. I really like to hear it. My name is Tom Schlansky. I'm from the Zeppelin University in Germany, so not Munich or Berlin, but from the south of Germany. And I have a very concrete question. So I was together for the last 3 years with a Russian girlfriend. So I was several times in Russia. I'm right now interning here in D.C. And when I look into Russian media and American media, especially when you look into Ukraine, I notice that there is a lot of tension, and that I'm a little bit feared of that there could be something like, not a new Cold War, but it's going a little bit into this direction. And I would be really interested. So Germany having strong ties with Russia, economic ties, so there is way more exchange than America is having it with Russia. And do you think that German diplomacy and Germany could do more to foster the understanding of Russia and America, that we can bring together young Russians, young Americans, and maybe young Germans, that we can be a bridge, that the people don't think that, you know, all the Russians are crazy and all the Americans. So do you think we can do more for that, and that we as Germans should do more for this issue?
I'm switching into German. Erstens mal freut mich, einen Studenten der Zeppelin-Universität hier zu sehen. Ich weiß nicht, ob wir uns bei meinem Vortrag an der Universität gesehen haben. Ansonsten habe ich gerade gelesen, dass Ihr Präsident die Universität verlassen will und nach neuen Ufern sucht. Dafür viel Glück. Ein bisschen schade, weil er wirklich ein sehr kreativer Präsident war und diese noch kleine Universität sehr bekannt gemacht hat. Was Russland angeht, wissen Sie, ich bemühe mich, bei all den Unterschieden und den unterschiedlichen Interessen, die zwischen unseren beiden Ländern bestehen, die Kanäle offen zu halten, immer denkend an den Satz von Kissinger, den ich vorhin zitiert habe, Außenpolitik ist eine Frage von Perception. Die Bewertung von Vorgängen, die mögen zwischen Ost und West sehr unterschiedlich sein, aber Außenpolitik kann eben nicht darin bestehen, auf Grundlage unterschiedlicher Bewertungen schlicht und einfach weiterzumachen, sondern immer wieder nach Möglichkeiten zu suchen, diese Bewertungen aneinander anzugleichen, von Missverständnissen und Irrtümern sie möglichst frei zu machen.
First, I would like to say how pleased and delighted I am to see a student from Zeppelin University here amongst the group of people. I don't know whether you were there at the time that I was at the university on the occasion of myself giving a speech there. I have just received news that your president is about to depart from the university seeking different challenges, something that I think is fair for him to do, but I nevertheless deplore the fact because I think that he is a very imaginative person, a very creative spirit, and he has done his utmost to make sure that this fairly small university has acquired a reputation over time. Now, as regards your question about Russia, I always try to keep open the channels, despite the fact that there are differences regarding our interests and the interests of the other country, Russia, that is. Always remembering what Kissinger once said, as I quoted in my speech, foreign policy is always a question of perception. Now, assessing the developments of late is something where, of course, the East and the West do not agree, where we differ and have different positions. But I don't believe that foreign policy would mean that we simply continue on that basis of both parties having different assessments of what's happening. I believe foreign policy is very much about seeking ways and means of talking to each other, trying to adapt to the changes in the situation, and trying to work on the basis of avoiding and doing away with errors and mistakes that have been made.
Um das konkret zu machen, als wir uns entschlossen haben, nach vielen Tagen des Blutvergießens in die Ukraine zu gehen, in einer Situation, in der es keine Garantie gab, ob eine diplomatische Bemühung Erfolg haben würde, haben wir auch da versucht, gemeinsam auf Russland einzuwirken, sich an den Bemühungen um das Ende des Blutvergießens zu beteiligen. Das ist nicht einfach in einer solchen Situation, in der neben den inneren Streitigkeiten in der Ukraine, ja in den großen geostrategischen Interessensgegensätzen immer auch die Frage eine Rolle spielt, gehört die Ukraine eher zum Westen oder eher zum Osten? Und mein Argument war von vornherein zu sagen, in einer Zeit des Blutvergießens und des internen Turmoils kann es jetzt nicht, ist es nicht zeitgemäß, darüber zu entscheiden, ob die Ukraine eher zum Osten oder zum Westen gehört, sondern vor allen Dingen das Blutvergießen zu beenden. Und das muss auch ein Interesse Russlands sein. Und deshalb haben wir Russland mit eingeladen. Russland war dann am Verhandlungstisch beteiligt durch den Beauftragten für Menschenrechte im Kreml, Herrn Lukin. Der, und das hat in der Öffentlichkeit bisher keine erhebliche Rolle gespielt, sich nicht nur an den Verhandlungen beteiligt, der hat sich nicht nur an den Verhandlungen beteiligt, sondern war an einigen Stellen sogar ausgesprochen hilfreich, um Brücken zwischen der damaligen politischen Führung der Ukraine und den Oppositionsgruppierungen zu schlagen. Insofern, ein Stück weit ist es sogar gelungen, Russland in diesen Prozess mit hineinzubeziehen. Jetzt allerdings sind wir in einer Situation im Streit um die Krim, bei der ich nicht weiß, ob wir die unterschiedlichen Interessen wieder zusammenbringen würden.
But to be more specific, more concrete now as regards your question, at the time where we were witnessing days of bloodshed, and at the end of that, we decided we had to go in and we had to travel to Ukraine in a situation where we had no guarantee whatsoever whether our diplomatic efforts would be successful at the end of the day. At the time, we tried to exert the influence that we have and that we had to make Russia join us in that endeavor, in that effort, to work with us in order to put an end to bloodshed. It wasn't easy, given the situation at the time where we were on the one hand witnessing an internal dispute, internal turmoil in Ukraine, where we also had different geostrategic interests of major proportions at the time. It wasn't sure whether Ukraine would be up to taking a decision of whether it belonged to the East or the West. It wasn't easy for us, but I've always maintained that in times of bloodshed and internal turmoil in a country like Ukraine, it is not the time to decide whether Ukraine belongs to the East or the West. That shouldn't be at the top of our agenda. What was at the top of our agenda at the time was to put an end to bloodshed. And that was something where we thought Russia should also have an interest in working towards that objective. And this is why at the time we invited Russia to also come in and do its bit. And actually they sent their human rights commissioner in the Kremlin, Mr. Lukin, who was there and who not only participated in the discussions, but who also time and again proved to be quite helpful in building bridges between the political leaders of Ukraine and the opposition in Ukraine. Insofar, it is fair to say that we have been somewhat successful in involving and including Russia in our endeavors. But right now, given the developments of late in Crimea, I am not in a position to say whether we will be able to, you know, bridge those varying interests and reach some kind of...
Vielleicht muss man noch hinzusagen, dass auch für mich die Lage, wie sie sich heute Morgen auf der Krim darstellt, ausgesprochen unklar ist. Wir hatten über die Nacht Nachrichten, dass der Flughafen und wichtige Teile der Infrastruktur besetzt worden sind durch uniformierte Personen, deren Zugehörigkeit nicht ganz klar war, die man aber als russischen Ursprungs bewertet. Heute Morgen gab es dann sehr früh eine Nachricht von der neuen ukrainischen Regierung, die zum Ausdruck bringt, dass die Flughäfen wieder unter Kontrolle der Regierung sind. Insofern haben wir im Augenblick eine etwas widersprüchliche Nachrichtensituation, bei der ich im Augenblick auch nicht alle offenen Fragen beantworten kann.
Perhaps one should also add that even for me, the situation as it presents itself right now, this very moment, this very morning in the Crimean, is unclear too. So it's very difficult to say where we stand, you know. During the night, we received news that the airport and that important elements of the infrastructure in Crimea had been occupied, taken possession of by people in uniform, and it wasn't quite clear where they belonged, which forts they represented, but we heard rumors and information pointing in the direction of them being of Russian origin. Then this very morning, we heard from the Ukrainian interim government that the airport was back under their control. So it is difficult for me, too, considering the fact that we've got different informations pointing in different directions to say what the situation is like right now.
Thank you. We'll take the next question. We'll take two from here, and then we'll move over to the other side.
Thank you very much, Fiona. Thank you, Minister Steinmeier, for a great speech. I want to move to England and the United Kingdom. Your Chancellor was there yesterday and was received with high honors, speaking for the House of Parliament, tea with the Queen. A marked contrast with Mr. Hollande, who only got a pub lunch from David Cameron. You say it's all about perception, so that's quite the perception. So my question is actually very simple. How far is Germany willing to go to accommodate the United Kingdom staying in the European Union and its future in the European Union in renegotiating terms of membership and accommodating some of the, I guess, concerns that Britain has in the future of the European Union? Thank you.
Ja, ich war vor 14 Tagen da, hatte keinen Tee bei der Königin, aber die Themen, die wir zu besprechen hatten, waren dieselben.
Well, I was there a fortnight ago. Unfortunately, I didn't have tea with the Queen, but the topics that were on our agenda were the same.
Ich bin der Meinung, wir haben eine echte Chance, die ökonomische Krise in der Europäischen Union zu überwinden. Aber wir sollten mehr darüber reden, wie wir die politische Krise Europas, in der wir auch sind, langfristig überwinden. Dazu kann es sein, dass wir unsere Regularien anpassen müssen. Dazu kann es auch sein, dass wir einige der Rechtsregeln werden ändern müssen. Die entscheidende Frage ist nur, und da unterscheiden wir uns, und das war sichtbar auf der Pressekonferenz, der Kanzlerin, ebenso wie ich das auf meiner Pressekonferenz in Erinnerung habe, wenn die Erwartung besteht, dass wir hinter den erreichten Integrationsstand in Europa zurückfallen sollten, dann sind wir halt anderer Meinung, weil wir sagen, diese europäische Integration auf diesem Stand ist ein Fortschritt, von dem wir bisher alle profitieren und den würden wir gerne halten. Das heißt nicht, dass man in einzelnen Feldern noch einmal nachschaut, wo das sogenannte Subsidiaritätsprinzip besser gewahrt bleibt, wo Dinge auf der europäischen Ebene entschieden werden oder worden sind, die auf der nationalen Ebene, was die Details angeht, möglicherweise besser entschieden werden können. Aber wir sind, was den grundsätzlichen Weg angeht, eben doch anderer Auffassung als viele unserer Freunde in Großbritannien, die den Integrationsstand zurückfahren möchten.
I am of the opinion, I'm of the view that we stand a genuine chance of overcoming the economic crisis within the European Union. But I believe we should talk more about whether we will also be able to overcome the political crisis, which also prevails in Europe. And I think that that might involve having to take a second look at some of the rules that have been applied. It might involve taking some legislative action. But the decisive point really is, and here I believe, if I remember the press conference of the Chancellor and my own press conference a fortnight ago correctly, this is the point where we differ from many of our British friends, because when it comes to us risking that we fall behind or roll back or go back on what we have already achieved by way of integration within the European Union, then we take a different view from our British friends. We believe that this integration that we've achieved over time in the European Union constitutes progress from which we all benefit. And this is why we would like to keep it up and maintain it. Which is not to say that there are certain areas where we should perhaps take a closer look or a second look, reviewing those areas where perhaps the principle of subsidiarity could be better applied than has been the case so far, where we have taken matters to the level of the European Union that could have been better determined or decided at the national level. But as to the fundamental path to pursue, we do not agree with many of our British friends here because they would like to, in a way, roll back or reduce European integration.
That was a question from Matthias Matisse, who is actually not British, but from another somewhat divided country at times in Belgium, but is a professor here in Washington, D.C. There's another question just behind, and then I'll come over to the other side of the room.
Thank you very much. My name is Victoria Rietig. I'm a policy analyst at the Migration Policy Institute. It's a think tank here in D.C. just around the corner. I woke up this morning to the news on Tagesschau.de that the no-spy treaty is dead. And instead, we're seeing a pivot now to, as you said, the cyber dialogue that would include civil society, government, and businesses, etc. Can you just flesh out that idea a little more to give us a better sense of what you have in mind? Thank you.
Aber das, was ich gestern auf der Pressekonferenz gesagt habe, ist, dass die Überschrift eines No-Spy-Abkommens Erwartungen geweckt hat, dass es nach Abschluss eines solchen Abkommens im Grunde genommen keine Tätigkeit von Geheimdiensten, amerikanischen Geheimdiensten in Europa oder in Deutschland mehr geben wird.
What I said yesterday at my press conference was that this heading of us negotiating a no-spy agreement created certain expectations at the time, and that those expectations were very much tied to the fact that once such an agreement would have been signed or would be signed, there would be no intelligence activities whatsoever on the part of the American intelligence services in Europe.
Wenn ich es richtig sehe, ist die amerikanische Erwartung eher, dass wir in einem No-Spy-Abkommen die Rechte von Geheimdiensten tätig zu werden regeln.
If I see it correctly, I think the American expectation is that such an agreement would in a way regulate the activities of American intelligence agencies in other countries.
Deshalb bin ich der Meinung, wir sind in der Tat, was unsere Erwartungen mit Blick auf die jeweiligen Bevölkerungen angeht, noch sehr weit auseinander. Und deshalb habe ich vorgeschlagen, lasst uns über verschiedene Dinge reden.
This is why I'm of the opinion that we are indeed quite a bit apart as regards the expectations at home in both countries, public expectations, that is. And this is why I said, let's talk about different subject matters.
Die erste Frage ist die, ist es aus amerikanischer Sicht wirklich notwendig, dass gegenüber einem Land, das in langer und enger Freundschaft zu den Amerikanern steht, ein Land, das täglich hunderte von personellen Kontakten der Regierungsmitglieder untereinander unterhält, ist es wirklich notwendig, dass man zusätzlich über die Geheimdienste Mitglieder der Bundesregierung noch abhört?
The first question that springs to mind is whether it is in the eyes of the Americans necessary with regard to a country with which one has been united in a long-standing and close friendship for many years and with which one has numerous regular daily contacts amongst the peoples, but also the members of the respective administrations, to add to that a lively activity of the intelligence services with regard to that country.
Ich bin überhaupt nicht der Mensch, der Security-Gesichtspunkte gering achtet. Ich frage mich aber bei einer solchen Abhörpraxis, wenn sie sich fortsetzt, ob sie nicht einfach der engen Freundschaft, die wir miteinander haben, unangemessen ist und ob sie nicht auch im amerikanischen Sinn eher geneigt ist, Misstrauen zu erzeugen, als dass es uns wirklich auch den Amerikanern im bilateralen Verhältnis etwas bringt.
You know, I'm really not the person who thinks lowly of security questions and security issues. But given the fact that this eavesdropping has been going on, this wiretapping has been going on, and given the fact that it might continue, I think we should think hard whether it is not inappropriate towards a long-standing and close friend, and whether it's not going to trigger the opposite effect, and that is rather so distrust. Instead of being beneficial, not even to the Americans.
Die andere Frage, die ich vorgeschlagen habe, etwas grundsätzlicher zu diskutieren, als wir das immer mit der Überschrift No Spy Abkommen diskutiert haben, ist die Frage, wie schaffen wir, ich habe es in meiner Rede auch kurz gesagt, wie schaffen wir diese richtige Balance zwischen Sicherheit und Freiheit oder wie man auch sagen könnte, zwischen Sicherheit und Privacy?
The other question that I suggested we talk about in a more principled way, instead of just, you know, talking under this motto or heading of both sides agreeing on a no-spy agreement, is the question, and I hinted at it in my speech earlier today, is how can we succeed to, in a way, strike the right balance between protection of privacy and guaranteeing security?
Und das sage ich jetzt überhaupt nicht borniert, schon deshalb nicht, weil wir in dieser Frage auch keine ideale Lösung haben. Bei dieser Abgrenzung von Sicherheit und Freiheit und Sicherheit von Privacy täte es uns, glaube ich, gut, wenn wir dazu in einen etwas fundamentaleren Dialog hineinkämen, weil wir ja Antworten finden müssen. Und diese Antworten liegen zum Beispiel auf der Hand, wenn wir gerade dabei sind, ein europäisch-amerikanisches Datenschutzabkommen zu verhandeln, wenn wir gerade dabei sind, über Ergänzungen des Safe Harbor Abkommens zu reden, da müssen wir solche Fragen sehr konkret beantworten. Und deshalb scheint es mir sehr sinnvoll, dass wir sehr schnell in einen Dialog hineinkommen, den ich Bilateral Cyber Dialog genannt habe und bei dem ich vorschlage, dass wir einen Diskussionsprozess starten, der sozusagen mit einer Veranstaltung Government to Government startet und dann mehr und mehr auch Wissenschaft und Civil Society einbezieht. Nicht, weil ich naiv glaube, wenn wir drei Veranstaltungen machen, sind wir einer Meinung. Der Meinung bin ich überhaupt nicht. So naiv kann man gar nicht sein. Aber dass man vielleicht nach einer solchen Reihe von gemeinsamen Begegnungen weiß, wo man sich mit guten Gründen voneinander unterscheidet und wo es auch keinem wehtut, wenn man sich in seinem Verständnis einander näher kommt.
And when I'm making these comments, I don't really want to be talking down my nose. Now, far be that idea for me, because we have to think of ourselves. We don't have the ideal solution to offer. All of us have to think hard about how better to strike a balance between security, freedom, liberty, and our privacy. And I believe that it is better for all of us, the Americans and the Europeans and the Germans included in that, to discuss this matter in a more fundamental way than we have done so far, because we need to have answers here. We have to find the right answers. It's necessary when you look to the European Union and the United States trying to agree on a data protection agreement. It is also required when you look to the fact that we are trying hard to amend and to add to the Safe Harbor Agreement. And for all these reasons, we need to find the right answers, all of us together. And that is something, you know, why I believe that it does make sense to have a more fundamental, a more principled dialogue, and that a dialogue that I have called a bilateral cyber dialogue. At the time, I suggested a dialogue which ought to begin with an event, an exchange of views at the level of the respective governments, the administrations, and then as a kind of second step, we should also see, in a third step, we should involve the experts, the technical experts, the scientific experts, and also members and representatives of civil society. Now, I am not so naive to believe that after having had these three events, everything will be fine and we will be in complete agreement. Far be that idea for me. I'm not as naive as that. But I believe that after having had these exchanges in several stages, we will have, in a way, acquired knowledge about where the other stand. We will be able to identify where the other side has justifiably a different view from our own position or view, but we will also perhaps be able to realize where it won't hurt us to take a step in the direction of the other country.
Thank you. Take a question over here on the aisle. A gentleman here. Yeah, you had your hand up before. Sorry, it was the gentleman behind you. I'm sorry. Yeah, hard always to tell. Yeah, we'll work on it.
Sorry for you.
Don't worry.
Like the gentleman in front of me, I'm sorry I don't belong anymore to the young generation.
We switched generations. That was what I was trying to do.
So it's also our turn.
Yes.
But in saying this, I must say when I started.
Can you identify yourself as well, please?
Yes, I will do this. My name is Lutz Beer, and I just want to say something for my defense of age. When I started in 68 in the German civil service, we created a lot of headaches to our superiors and to the whole German bureaucracy. So I think it was a very healthy thing, and I agree with the minister. I think we should listen very often to our children and get reminded that we were not different. Now, the reason why I want to bring a question up here is a little far-fetched question, but I hope in the premises of this institution it is allowed.
Sure.
The question which I have, wouldn't it be better if, and I'm referring to the situation in Ukraine, if Ukraine and Russia would be potential candidates for the European Union in the future. Because I think these conflicts would not happen if Russia were also a member of the European Union. It is far-fetched, but we should not forget in the year 1992, the president of the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, Mr. Jacques Attali, he introduced the vision of a Europe which started in the west from the Azore Islands until the Bering Strait, bordering, so to say, with US territory. and was, of course, including Russia. It was definitely too early at that time, because I don't think that Jacques Attali finished his term. There was a lot of political waves which he created. But nevertheless, I just wanted to bring this into discussion. If this is not something we should at least consider in future discussions too. Thank you.
While you're contemplating that thought, I'll ask the gentleman who just so that you got a chance to also ask a question, and please identify yourself.
All right. I'm Norman Birnbaum from Georgetown University and The Nation magazine. My question is the following. President Obama has had an enormous amount of difficulty dealing with the economy because of political resistances and ideological resistances and material resistances to an expansion program which would involve reconstruction of infrastructure, which he mentioned the other day, and a general return to the New Deal and traditions of a larger state participation in stimulating the economy. The details are well known. One of the odd things about the situation is that the president has had to keep reminding the Europeans, and in particular the European Union, that austerity won't work. And yet what we have in Europe are two major political formations, the social Christian parties and the parties of the European Socialist grouping, which have traditions of a welfare state, of a strong state capital labor cooperation, and yet this tradition does not appear to have been modernized or to have been intensively applied in the current crisis. Now, the coalition you serve in Germany is a particularly interesting and fruitful one in view of the German public's attachment to the welfare state. Do you think that we in this country might get some more cooperation in this sense in an anti-austerity program which would really seek to expand and reconstruct the economies? And I may add that if the Ukraine is an improbable candidate for admission to the European Union, so, alas, is the one country that would probably profit the most from it, namely the United States.
Ah, well, there we are. Okay, so we have an expansion. If we go far enough along the Bering's Straits, can we also bring the United States into the EU? Yes.
Ja, ich meine, beide Fragen berühren ein politikwissenschaftliches Thema, das oft beschrieben worden ist und leider auch viele Beispiele enthält. Overstretching von Imperien. Die Europäische Union ist weit davon entfernt, sich als Imperium zu bezeichnen, aber ich glaube, sie tut gut daran, sich nicht zu überschätzen in ihrer Integrationsfähigkeit. Zu der ersten Frage, die ist heute vielleicht sogar viel einfacher zu beantworten als noch vor einigen Jahren. Es gibt inzwischen ja eigene Konzepte, die in Russland entwickelt worden sind, die ein, ich sage nicht Gegenmodell, die ein eigenes Modell einer regionalen Kooperation im Osten, sogenannte Eurasische Union, bilden sollen. Mal unabhängig davon, wie viele Mitglieder die haben wird, wie viel Bereitschaft besteht, sich daran zu beteiligen. Jedenfalls, wenn es um regionale Kooperation geht, entwickelt sich im Osten etwas Eigenes. Insofern steht die Frage einer EU-Mitgliedschaft, wie Attali sie mal aufgeworfen hat vor vielen Jahren, nicht mehr an. Und ich bin mir nicht mal sicher, ob Attali diese Auffassung heute noch vertritt.
Well,
Indeed, these two topics, these two questions have been discussed by political experts and scientists for a long time and have been often described, unfortunately, also involving and giving many examples of empires overstretching themselves. And now, I wouldn't go as far as to claim that the European Union conceives of itself as an empire, but I think the European Union would be well advised not to overestimate its ability to integrate and to integrate others. Coming to your first question, which I believe is somewhat easier to answer these days than it may have been a couple of years ago, because in the recent past, Russia has set about developing its own concepts, a concept not of a, I would go as far as to call it a counter model, but a concept of its own model for an integration of the countries in its immediate vicinity, what they call the Eurasian Union. Now, independent of the fact how many members that union will eventually have and how big the readiness of the countries in question to participate is, as regards cooperation and integration in the region, something is happening in the East. They're developing their own model. Now, as far as membership in the European Union, Russian membership in the European Union is concerned, that question that Mr. Attali raised a couple of years ago, it is thus not on the agenda right now, and I am not even sure that Mr. Attali would still stand by the suggestion that he made at the time. Today.
Normans Frage habe ich fast erwartet.
Now, as concerns the question of Norman, I almost expected that question.
Norman, manchmal bin ich mir nicht sicher, ob wir, wenn wir über Austeritätspolitik reden, auf beiden Seiten des Atlantiks wirklich dasselbe meinen.
Norman, you know, sometimes I'm not really sure that when we talk about austerity on both sides of the Atlantic, that we're really talking about the same thing.
Das, was wir zum Beispiel in Deutschland im Augenblick tun, ja, das ist auch eine Politik mit Haushaltsdisziplin und dem Versuch, den Stand der Neuverschuldung für die Zukunft nicht weiter zu erhöhen, sondern eher zu reduzieren.
What we have, for example, striving to do right now in Germany is, in a way, a policy that involves, yes, budgetary discipline. Yes, we are trying to, if not reduce our new debt, our new indebtedness, at least not to see it rise.
Wir tun das natürlich auf einer Basis eines entwickelten Wohlfahrtsstaates, dessen größter Teil der Ausgaben neben Militär eben die Sozialausgaben sind.
And of course, we are doing that on the basis of us being a well-developed welfare state, with the greatest part of its expenditure going apart from into the military expenditure, into the social state, into the social system.
Wenn ich mir anschaue, wie in der aktuellen Haushaltspolitik, wir sind gerade in Haushaltsverhandlungen, die Ausgaben im Bereich Renten, Familienpolitik, Gesundheitspolitik sich entwickeln, dann komme ich mit Blick auf diese Entwicklung in den Haushalten eigentlich nicht zu dem Ergebnis, das ist Austeritätspolitik.
Now, when I look at our budgetary policy right now, because we are right in the midst of budget negotiations, and when I take a look at the development that our expenditure on pension payments, on expenditure on families and health provision is concerned, when I look at these developments here, I wouldn't feel, you know, tempted to conclude that the policy we are pursuing is a policy that could claim to be called a policy of austerity.
Aber das eine Beispiel Deutschland steht natürlich nicht für ganz Europa. Und ich ahne, dass deine Frage natürlich eher inspiriert war von den Entwicklungen, die wir in größeren Teilen Europas im Augenblick feststellen und die in diesen größeren Teilen Europas eben auch von Rezession begleitet ist.
But that one example, the example of Germany, of course, is not representative of Europe as a whole. And if I'm honest, you know, I have this feeling, the sense that when you put that question, you were in a way hinting at the fact that there is a development taking place in vast parts of Europe, in countries there, that involves a bigger recession than we have witnessed in Germany.
Und das bringt mich in der Tat zu dem Punkt, dass ich mit Blick auf unsere eigene deutsche Entwicklung seit der Zeit in Deutschland der kranke Mann Europas war, vor gut 10 Jahren, natürlich auch die Erinnerung und die Feststellung mitgenommen habe, dass schlicht und einfach fantasieloses Cutting von Ausgaben noch zu keiner Besserung der Situation führt.
Which brings me to that one important realization, you know, looking to the development in my own country, looking to the fact that only 10 years ago Germany was called the sick man of Europe, it leads me to the realization that unimaginative cutting of expenditure alone is not enough to really improve the situation.
Wir haben in Deutschland den Turnaround im Grunde genommen hinbekommen, in einer mit 3 miteinander ausbalancierten Elementen. Das eine war in der Tat strengste Haushaltsdisziplin. Das zweite waren Strukturreformen. Und das dritte gilt aber auch, dass wir uns in die Lage versetzt haben, in einem zwar kleinen Umfang, aber dennoch Investitionen aufrechtzuerhalten.
Now in Germany we succeeded in bringing about the turnaround by actually focusing and balancing 3 different elements, the first of which indeed was very strict budgetary discipline. The second was carrying out infrastructural reforms. And the third, yes, we were succeeding.
Structural reforms, yes.
And third, we were successful, although to a limited extent only, but to keep investing into our economy.
Und das Verhältnis dieser 3 Elemente zueinander ist nicht immer bei allen Veränderungen, insbesondere in südeuropäischen Staaten, beachtet worden. Und da müssen wir möglicherweise nachsteuern. Ich komme jetzt gerade vor wenigen Tagen aus Spanien zurück. Wir haben in Spanien jetzt eine Entwicklung, wo sich zum ersten Mal nach vielen Jahren der ökonomischen Krise die Zahlen leicht verbessern und wir auch damit rechnen können, dass die Belastung der Arbeitslosenstatistiken in den nächsten Jahren zurückgehen wird.
And it is the relationship between these 3 elements that hasn't always been respected fully, despite the fact that changes have been carried out by many countries in the southern part of Europe. I think we have to act here and to do something to readjust that. I've just returned from a trip to Spain a couple of days ago, where for the very first time after the dire economic crisis, the figures are picking up, are looking slightly more positive. And I think we have reason to be hopeful to increase our expectations that the unemployment figures are going to go down some.
Dasselbe trifft zu für Irland und Portugal, die aus den öffentlichen europäischen Surveillance-Programmen inzwischen wieder raus sind, auf eigenen Füßen stehen. Ein großes Problem bleibt Griechenland. Darüber haben wir heute Morgen mit Christine Lagarde auch noch einmal geredet.
It is also true for Ireland and Portugal. Both countries have left the surveillance program that the European Union has and that they have agreed upon with the respective organizations, and they now stand on their own feet again. Greece, however, continues to be a big problem, and I talked about this earlier today with Christine Lagarde.
Es wird auch in den kommenden Jahren noch nicht ganz einfach sein, die griechische Wirtschaft zu stützen, weil das, was dringend fehlt, nämlich Investitionen, öffentliche und private Investitionen, so recht bisher noch keinen Ankerpunkt hat, da wo Griechenland in der Vergangenheit stark war, etwa in der Schiffbauindustrie. Das sind Strukturen, die zu einem größeren Anteil inzwischen nicht mehr bestehen, bis ein heute wichtiger Anteil der Wirtschaft, die Tourismusinfrastruktur, so weit aufgebaut ist, dass sie mehr Revenues erzielt, als das in der Vergangenheit der Fall war. Das wird dauern, da muss man dranbleiben. Aber es wird eben auch bedeuten, dass wir aus den europäischen Programmen über die Mittel der Europäischen Investitionsbank mehr Mittel zur Verfügung stellen, die zu Investitionen zur Verfügung stehen. Mehr Mittel bereitstehen, die zu in Investitionen fließen.
Which is to say that the situation is going to not be easy in a couple of years to come with regard to supporting the Greek economy, because what they really need is investment. And I'm talking public and private investments here. And for investments, it's still very difficult to identify the right point of where they ought to be made. You know, in the past, Greece was very strong when it came to shipbuilding. But that is an area where the structure, the industrial structure, no longer exists. Another area where Greece has been able to perform relatively well is tourism. Tourism continues to produce more income now than it has done for many years. But it is still something that takes time to, you know, become effective in a way that also the people realize what is happening, which is to say that we will have to continue to make funds available in the framework of the European programs, the programs set up by the EIB that can then go into investments in Greece.
Und die ganze Wahrheit, und das ist die Frage zum Schluss, wenn mehr Finanzmittel erforderlich sind, wo sollen sie herkommen? Das sind Fragen, die auch in Europa nicht ganz einfach zu diskutieren sind, die vielleicht auch zwischen Europa und den USA unterschiedlich gesehen werden. Wir haben uns zum Beispiel in Europa stark gemacht für eine Besteuerung von Finanzmarktprodukten. Das ist umstritten in Europa. Es gibt eine Größenordnung von 10, 11 Ländern, die das mittlerweile unterstützen. Aber wir ringen darum, dass wir hier auch zusätzliche Einnahmemöglichkeiten verschaffen, um daraus dann wiederum Investitionen finanzieren zu können.
The whole truth, and that is really the final question as concerns this topic, is if we now agree on the need for further investment of more funds, where are these additional funds to come from? And that is a point where we have a debate, about which we have a debate in Europe. We are not in agreement on that, you know. And I believe it's also probably fair to say that perhaps the United States and Europe are not in agreement on where these funds ought to come from. We, for one, believe that the funds could be generated by taxing financial products. As I said, we have a debate about this in Europe, and not all countries in Europe agree. But I think it's also fair to say that there is a group of 10 to 12 countries in Europe that support that approach and that idea, and believe that in proceeding in that way, we can generate additional income that can then go into investments.
Well, unfortunately, we've also run out of one of the most critical of our reserves and resources, which is time. And although there might be a little bit left on the Brookings clock, your clock, unfortunately. You know, I'm very sorry about this. We really can't, because I've been. Yes, please. I'm really sorry about this. There were a lot of other questions that people wanted to ask as well. I'm really sorry about this. The foreign minister has to go to his next meeting. We've been already signaled that his time is up. I would be very happy to resolve that question with you outside of the door, please. Can we have a round of applause for the foreign minister? And I'll take up this question. I'm so sorry. Thank you.